We're recording, so brief introduction to Ron.
Ron Whitehurst.
Rincon Vitova Insectaries, our advisor on integrated pest management for open source ecology. And we're going to go through a detailed discussion, lots of questions. We'll have a lot of time for questions. We have we were thinking about having Ron discussing the whole integrated pest management question for a bit of time and then maybe get into a number of questions. But we have up to 2 hours to do this, so there's plenty of time to get the questions, but really try to get it focused to the very practical applications, like, okay, next week or right now, what are we doing to make things make things good? What are we doing in a week, or what are we doing in over the next year? Because what we'll be doing, part of it, what I didn't mention, is we are also installing an Internet of Things camera where you can log into an IP number and actually see what's going on in the greenhouse from remote. So we're going to, everyone actually has a chance to monitor what's going on within a greenhouse here. So it's an experiment. It's both for us and also for the world to see what that's about. And hopefully with the integrated pest management techniques, it's going to be green and very green throughout the year. Okay, so Ron, please take it away. Welcome to Factory Farms crew. So I'll turn it around,
and
maybe.
Probably mute it too.
Yeah, we're going to mute ourselves.
Somebody want to pick up his cell phone?
And here's here's who we have, but you're not going to really see them too well.
Can't hear you.
Oh, whoops. Okay. Okay, Ron.
Great to see you, y'all. So, integrated pest management is controlling pests using an integrated approach, using a broad range of different actors to control the pest instead of just picking a pesticide off of a chart that would be appropriate for that particular pest. So this is what our great-grandfathers and great-great-grandfathers and grandmothers did, you know, in their gardens. And so it's kind of, you know, returning to the methods of our ancestors, in a sense, that in the organic principles, a healthy plant resists pests and disease. And so pest control, you know, starts with the soil, with the soil food web, building up from that, and looking at all the different factors. So outside, the you know, Mother Nature provides the sun, the rain, and the air circulation, and all these other things. When you put up walls, then you have to take on more of those functions. And so it's a bit more active, more engineered environment, so that we have to take on some of the roles that nature provided outside. So we'll, you know, talk about those different aspects. So as gardeners, well, how many of you are gardeners? I guess that's one of the questions. You know, who's my audience?
About 40 okay. People.
Almost everybody's done a little something, huh? Very good. So, you know that if you put too much nitrogen on a plant, you know, whether from, you know, out of bag of chemicals or, you know, too much chicken manure, that you push the lush, soft growth of the plants, and that makes the plant, you know, really juicy looking, but it's also really attractive to all of the sucking and chewing insect pests. And so managing your plants so they have enough nutrition, but not too much, you know, is an important aspect. So, let's see, where to go. Okay, so integrated pest management usually looks at the cultural, physical, biological, and all these different aspects together. And then as an insectary, we're particularly interested in biological. Put together some notes and the...
Does everyone else have their tech in airplane mode?
I share this with the group. So, in a sense, the conventional pest control is kind of a real macho activity, where you're looking at controlling or dominating something. And biological control, you know, incorporates more of the traditionally attributed feminine qualities, you know, partnership, relationships, nurturing, and that sort of thing. So this is what we like to look at is the relationship, you know, between the plants and the insects, and the relationship between the microbes, how they work to supply the nutrients to the plants, and they also may be diseases, you know, to the insects, so they may actually be partners with the insects so that they can grow better. There's some amazing examples there. So all the things that almost all the things, with maybe one or two exceptions, will be acceptable in an organic program. So that if you're looking at representing your products as organic, you know, there shouldn't be any problem. So we've got quite a list, ambitious list of crops, and so they kind of break down into a couple of different categories as far as the way we would look at them from the standpoint of pest control in a greenhouse. So lettuce, arugula, basil, cilantro, green onions, and garlic, and so on would be we treat those like we would the culinary herbs, that they would have similar pests and similar problems. So we'll look at those as a group. And then all of the cabbage plants, you know, will have similar pest problems, so we'll look at those separately. And I put together an IPM toolkit. These are some of the things that you might consider using as part of a toolkit, a package for controlling pests biologically. And one of those is a refractometer. It's a little device. You take some of the plant material and use something like a garlic press to squeeze some of the juice out of the plant, put it on this little device, and then look through the device at the light. And then you get a reading on the sugar content of the plant. And it's been found that the higher the sugar content, it's measured in a reading called BRICS, the less problems a plant has with pests and disease. And so it can be like a quick report card about how you're doing. Different plants have a different range of BRICS readings for you know, what's healthy for them. With a wide diversity of plants in the greenhouse, you'd have to keep a log of, you know, what the BRICS reading for that particular plant represents as far as, you know, in the spectrum of, you know, not so healthy to very healthy.
Ron, can I interrupt you for a second? This BRICS meter, how expensive is this?
They're about $80.
Okay.
So it's a little optic device, no batteries, and figuratively powered by the sun. So it's
okay. So that's something we'd want to invest in.
That, you know, like a larger garden could, you know, reasonably afford.
Okay.
Or
thank you.
You could partner. You could go into the you know, tool co-op category.
Mm-hmm.
And that USB microscope. Everybody's seen these little hand lens and look through a microscope. And it takes us about 20 minutes to teach people how to use a microscope. But there's these USB microscopes that plug into the USB port of the computer and then project the image on the screen. And most people know how to watch a screen and get information off of it. So it's really accessible technology. So you see these little creepy crawlies, you know, up close and personal on the computer screen. Those are running about $40 now. So they're really accessible. Then there's hand lens, which is really useful for you know, walking around and looking at things. Lets you see some of the details of little mites and chips and things like that. Sticky cards, those are really handy. They're kind of a passive thing to, they're just kind of hanging out there. And so passing insects that are usually flying will stick onto the card, and so you can see, you know, what's flying around. So the things that are walking around won't get onto the sticky cards unless they happen to fall on it. But it's a handy monitor to see what's there. And then as far as attractants, there's either vanilla or almond extract is really handy for attracting thrips, which is one of the common pests on a lot of the greens that you'll be growing in the greenhouse. Then to mount the sticky cards, a double-sided clothespin is handy. Take two clothespins, glue them together, and so you have a double-ended clothespin. And then you clip one to like a bamboo stake or a stick from the garden, and the other into the sticky card, so you can mount that near the top of the canopy for sampling for a lot of different pests. And then potato slices are really handy. You slice up a potato, and about a quarter inch thick, about 1 inch square, and snuggle that into the soil. And that's a really good way to monitor for fungus gnats. Then a really important piece of equipment is a beet sheet. So it's basically like a white piece of paper that you hold underneath a section of a plant. You beat on the plant, the insects fall onto the sheet, and so it's really easy to see the insects in contrast to the paper. Where a light green insect against a dark green plant doesn't show up very well. So that it's a great way of monitoring for, you know, a wide range of different plant pests that are on the plant. So in the soil, a pitfall trap or something like that works better. Then Ziploc bags are usually handy to have handy so that you can grab a leaf or something like that and then you know, take it over and show it to somebody else who may have more experience with you. Then for trap crop, there's a lot of people who've looked at a wide range of different trap crops for different plants. There's a special black emperor pepper, and there's the hero yellow marigold that have been found to be very effective. But the baseline seems to be beans, just either bush beans or pole beans. You just stick some of those in a pot and they'll come up, and it's a tremendous magnet for thrips, aphids, spider mites, a wide range of different pests in the greenhouse. And so it's really handy for monitoring. So if there's spider mites around, they're going to be on the beans. And so you don't have to wander all around the greenhouse. You just look at the bean plants. And can give a quick handle on you know what the situation is with the spider mites. Then insect food. We put together this mix of dried berries, yeast, sugar, and organic soy flour, and it's a supplemental food for feeding beneficial insects, and it's kind of like a caramone also, a feeding attractant for drawing in beneficial insects, you know, outside. But, for some of the larger mobile insects like lacewing adults and ladybugs. You can make this into a thin paste, smear it onto little strips of plastic, like sections of milk jug or yogurt container or something like that. And then place that around in the greenhouse, punch a hole in the plastic and use a little twist pipe to mount that in the greenhouse. You can provide supplemental food for insects. So let's see, I've put together a list of some of the different pests that might be encountered. Thought we'd check and see where people are as far as any questions at this point.
Any questions here?
What were the ingredients on the paste for the beneficial insects?
Ingredients on an insect food?
Yeah, basically it's the base formula is about half and half. Rivers use. It comes from a recipe like for artificial pollen that's used by beekeepers. And I mix it about two parts sugar, one part dried brewer's yeast, and one part organic soy flour. So there's a wide range of different nutrients in it. Dried brewer's yeast is about 45% protein, so it's as a higher concentration as soybeans for protein. And it has a wide range of different vitamins and enzymes and cofactors and such. They're really good for growing a wide range of different insects. And you can mix it with a small amount of water and make it into a paste and smear it or paint it on something. Or you can mix it with more water, about half pound to almost as much as 1 pound per gallon of water, and then spray it on large droplets widely scattered as a feeding attractant. Ken Hagen back in the 60s did some interesting work on that as supplemental food and as an attractant to draw in the beneficial insects from the surrounding areas to focus on particular plants. So in context of conservation biological control, where you're working with the natural enemy complex, it's useful to be able to not just put lab-reared insects out, but to manipulate the insects in the environment. So flowering plants are an important resource for a lot of different beneficial insects, like lacewing adults. The green lacewing adult is a vegetarian, and so why would you want to have a vegetarian come to your garden if you're trying to grow, plants to eat? The adult's attracted by nectar from flowers and then honeydew, the sticky poop from aphids, whitefly, mealybug, the sucking insects, and then deposits eggs and her kids. The lacewing larvae are vicious predators, and they'll eat all kinds of soft-bodied insects. So they'll eat aphids, whitefly, mealybug, small caterpillars, spider mites, and the eggs of a lot of different insects. So they're really great to have around. And so you can have those in your usual garden by just putting having some a flower resource. So it can be your crop plants. A few of them that you allow to go to flower, such as the cilantro or dill. Those flowers are the what used to be Umbelliferae, now called Apiaceae family. It has that broad, flat flower head with a lot of little flowers, and so it has pollen, and nectar that's available to a wide range of different beneficial insects. From the little tiny microscopic wasp like Trichogramma, that's about a hundredth of an inch long, up to your really big insects like the lacewing adults and serpent flies.
How do you know that you're not feeding the non-beneficial insects at the same time?
That was a good question.
Your question broke the internet.
How do we know that?
They eat the plants.
So they eat a different food. Okay.
Well, the ones that
Makes sense. Let's see if we can.
Okay,
we're back. We're back. Okay. Any whoops.
We're back again.
Okay, more questions on this part so far.
So ask him the question.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, so the question here was, how do we know that we're not feeding the non-beneficials with the foods you mentioned?
Okay. There's kind of trust that the beneficial will give the benefit. You can feed the ants, which are a major competition for the beneficial insects, and so. There is a danger that you will be feeding the pest insects, but you will need to manage the ants separately. And so I'll talk about techniques for doing that.
Okay, so there is some dangerous something.
I have a question.
More questions.
What is the soy... what is the purpose of the soy in that beneficial insect supplement, and is there something else you could substitute?
Sure. You can use just the sugar and dried brewer's yeast. I thought that the soy would offer some different plant-based proteins and some other nutrients that come with it. Most of the soy would be roasted, and so some of the more delicate enzymes and things like that would have been destroyed, but it would have a different complex of nutrients other and different than the yeast, which is usually fed on, some kind of grain, but it's a byproduct of brewing beer. But I was going for a bit of different variety, and it's commonly an ingredient in the artificial pollen for bees.
Other questions? I think we're ready to go, or let's see. Go ahead.
I don't know. Are you taking general questions right now, or just
maybe on this section for now?
Yeah,
let's have the download first. Okay, Ron, please go ahead.
Okay, so you want to go through the. Would you like to go through the list of plants and pests?
Yeah, maybe we can go to an overview. Are you going to talk about the soil food web and the sprays more? Or, because I think that's critical, and we are going to use that.
Okay.
Do you have any comments on that, or were you going to cover that?
Sure, I can cover that.
Okay, so maybe cover that. Okay. And then go into the specific.